solve AV issues? Not at all. Woo! Well, how are you all enjoying your Magfest so far? Yes! And can we get a quick hand for all the volunteers? Because, man, this is... fix AV issues, I will pretend as if I've got something to say to buy us some time. You got it! Red has it! You, sir, are a king on the man! You still not getting out of this panel, Red. Alright, so... So there is one minor issue. As you can see, no one here is Dan. Dan is sick, so we moved him.
Aww.
It's unfortunate, right? He'll be okay. But, so now it's become James and Friends. So, anything you want to ask about credits, about video game development, about history, and that stuff, feel free to direct my way, but I brought people. But they want to ask some other things, right? What if there are other aspects? So I brought people I know and love who are experts in the areas of management. They're a lot. So we want to introduce yourself to start event from right and left.
Hello, my name is Red Sherrison. I'm a film editor. You've seen some of my movies. So if anybody wants to ask a question that I probably don't know the answer for?
Definitely do. But honestly, if you have any questions, if any of you ever wanted to make films, be in the film industry, Red does very, very professional things in the film industry. And if anything fixes our AV.
Hello, I'm also sadly not Dan. My name is Matthew Cole. I work in Film's Little Brother Television. I will hopefully be able to answer any of your television production questions if that ever comes up, and web content as well, so be hot.
And if you want to make disparaging comments about television in relation to film, definitely.
Yeah.
It's the lesser video!
Now, what Netflix says...
I don't know what you're doing.
actually working? Yes, it's working. Awesome. So I'm actually going to hand this mic down to you because we have one more person who we physically could not fit on the stage, but I wanted to make sure we could answer everything you could possibly ask. So come stand and be recognized. Oh, and also, Davey is a person to ask tutorial and fashion questions to. And also, I'm good at really good at asking a lot. I'm just going to leave this one with you, so you could have it down there. Right.
Hi, everybody. I'm Joe Newman. I am a lawyer in the games industry. I've been doing legal work for a while. I'm different capacities. I've worked for organizations such as Public College, the Peer Foundation. I worked with James a couple years back on a video on Silver Keep Up. Helped work on that. And now I work for a little startup company called Electronic Arts. So my specialty is in privacy, consumer protection, and e-commerce. So also have a little bit of stuff in IP, but I'm not yet at. And happy to answer questions. Oh, and this isn't legal advice, and I'm not representing
you. It's
like a drinking game.
Cool, thanks.
So there's supposed to be a video, and Dan was supposed to have something to say, but none of those have materialized. So, we're just here to answer questions. Any of you guys want to come up, line it up at this mic, we'll answer everything and anything. And if your question doesn't get answered, don't worry about it. We've got a second room to move to after this when other people in this room answer as many questions as we can for a right time. Or before any of So, alright, hit me!
Worth noting that the last time James did this, the panel ended at 7 in the morning.
At 9.5 hours, which is currently the Magfest record.
Okay, guess what? You get this one.
Thank you. Hello, all. Just real quick, Davey, I was in a contemporary fictions class at the University of Virginia this last year where we had the beginner's guide as part of the curriculum. And had really wonderful discussions about narrative, and we loved the game, and it made us feel deep feelings. So thank you for
thank you very much.
That experience. I have a question for James. I read Horace Walpole's The Castle of Otranto this year. I would like to hear your thoughts on the son of the great Walpole.
So I actually want to do an extra just like one-off on him at some point because he's such an amusing character. Do you know like the rest of his life?
He had a very close friend that he kind of wrote, like that he invented the Gothic novel, and I can't remember the name of his really close friend that also did writing.
Did you know about his art gallery?
No.
So he loved and hated art. He had this really weird relationship with art. So he built this gallery, which was like this fake-looking Greek area, and he only had imitations and counterfeits of great pieces of art in there. And it was brilliant. But I love him because he's such a wacky character. So for those of you who don't know, in extra history reference all the time because he touched basically everything. His son ended up under a pen name writing the first gothic romantic novel. And that is his fellow. And it's fantastic, and I've got him inspired to read great work. Thanks so much. So this question is tragically, as much as I'd like to applaud every question, I feel like we're going to get more questions if we don't, so let's give the applause to me.
So this question is mainly for James. I know in Dan's last video before the, what are you saying, Dan recommends that this has been sort of the busiest year for extra credits. I imagine it continues to grow and get more employees and all that. I was just wondering what your dreams are now that it's continued to grow bigger than it ever has for the upcoming years, and what your vision of that is.
So that's a really good question. There's some stuff in the works that I don't know if you can talk yet. And since I can't ask Dan right now, I'll give you a shout out all that. ExtraGrid does continue to grow. We are bringing on more artists. Well, we love this point to put out all the videos. We're really adding more videos. I am looking at, I want to run some new shows as well. I am getting a couple other people. I'm going to continue to write the vast majority of ExtraGrid, but I'll probably find a guest writer for like 1 month. So that way I can start doing other shows as well, because there's a bunch of things that interest me. I definitely want to, since playing Bloodborne, I wanted to write a Jungian analysis of Bloodborne. I'm convinced Bloodborne is a technological landscape in the same way as Alpha 2 is, and I became everything as the symbolic inner workings of the character's head. You get this really, really interesting story. And there's sort of the voice center, right? The whole beginning is like, you can take this all the time. And then when you get insight, what do you see? You see actual parts of the brain, right? Like, that those monsters are named after parts of the brain. That's what you see as a game instance. You start to realize this in your head. So that, I would, for myself, I would love to get to write that one. I also want to work on how we analyze games if we take them and look at them the exact same way we look at everything else, right? We don't do it differently. I'd love to do a series on sort of history sci-fi, because we're at this amazing point in science fiction where it's existing for long enough that you can trace it more or less. What stood the test of time. And at the same time, it's smaller than like 2 or 3 years, we could actually trace, not obviously not going all over all the seminar, but trace all the seminal works that lead us to where we are today. And in some ways, I think that science fiction is a very important sort of literary development of the last 200 years. And other than that, I also want to look at other media. Because while I love games, there's some very interesting things that are happening outside of games as well that I like to look at. And then I want to just expand, I want to do more extra insight. There you go. Hello. You guys are each wearing a business for what happened to me, Sunbro shirt. Alright.
Let me start off by saying, please do make that one more thing. That sounds amazing. Okay, but my actual question, I kind of assume it'll be more leading to this, but assuming our copyright system ever sorts itself out, are there any games you guys would like to see in the public domain?
Interesting.
You got it. This is not legal advice, by the way. But games that I would personally like to see so that everybody could access would be, I'd go back to the old rules, I think over a certain number of years old. That's what it used to be, right?
It's still technically it. Well, it's
they keep making the years longer, though, right?
Yeah,
it's so silly.
Do you want to do a brief breakdown on why most games are not in the home domain and verify civilians? Areas that people are less familiar with.
No, I can't. No, No, I'll just say that in general, copyright is life of the author plus 7 years. That keeps going. When you have a game that's not necessarily a work for just a single author, you have other rules, you know, things about work for hire. It's a little bit complicated. But as to your question of games that I'd like to see in the public domain, or characters. I think it'd be really cool to have Final Fantasy characters, like Final Fantasy VII in the public domain. People do other things with those characters. That's just personal.
Yeah,
Alright, just while you guys are pulling your time.
Pretty much. I mean, honestly, I can just by call you Mario. It's like, you know, how many takedowns did Nintendo do this year alone in the parade? And it's like, the number of, like, how many people out there start making games like Flash games by just ripping Mario sprites and just plugging them into, you know, some framework. And so it's like, it would be nice if that were, I feel like that would be more supportive to new artists creating new stuff, because that's the strongest reference point for them. It might just be the easiest way to, you know, for them to feel inspired and start making new stuff.
I'd actually like to see some of the old tabletop rule sets, the public domain, they actually move it into the current regime. Like some of the original set level monsters are D&D along with us. D&D.
It's part of the anti-circumvention rules in the copyright law. There are rules about breaking the content protection on video game consoles, DVD players, things like that. I can't remember how many years it is, but the Copyright Office, the Copyright Office does a rulemaking where they people can advocate for exemptions, and this allowed people to do like homebrew and like crack their own asses to do other stuff, and you know, Game Boys to make them chiptunes, things like that. And that it requires, in a lot of cases, not so much for the older hardware, but for newer things like the PS4, cracking that stuff requires you get around the content protection. And that's an area where there's a whole homebrew community and like tinkerers and even researchers that aren't able to publish their work because they're afraid of copyright people coming after them. So that would be a great area of reform.
Now
yes, so I'd like to see some characters get into the public domain, so that characters, locations, in early UD campaigns. I'd love to see what happens when people in places you know, like the Snow White public domain, so you can make a story with Snow White, and make a name of Snow White, whatever you want. Doesn't mean you have to tell the same story. Right. So I'd love to see not so much just games for non-people to keep playing, but I'd love to see those locations that become part of culture, available to anybody to write any story that involves their locations and people types.
What would be interesting is source games. So, you know, it could be probably the game of the game now, but it could be that as a new scene that you come up with a new, say, theme, then hold it like the whole, like, version of it.
Those are unfortunately tangled with the players right now, the players. That's more than just that.
I mean, it's just sort of a personal thing, but like, I feel like if they release some old characters like Red Knight's screenplays for the Bodybuilder Cinematic Universe, we could actually get those to happen. So that's my answer.
Blurbs of things
they
can make
into
That would be super great too. Whatever, man. Pipe dreams, but think about it. Somebody make Blur up, please. Hashtag make Blur great.
But no, what everybody said is really good. I like the MMO, especially because I agree that communities and social aspects are so important to allow a person like myself who lacks certain social skills to be able to interact with a family and lose that family. That's important. Personally, I would like to see the Fantasy Star universe. Just so I can play the damn game, but that's just a big personal thing for me. All the way down to the Universal Sprites, you know, just as much as the property as I can get. Very selfish, just all around. That's all right.
I do miss real Fantasy Stars.
Yeah.
But all right, thank you, and we'll
thank you very much.
After this.
Hey there, guys. And hold up in a corner ball. So I have a question for you guys, right? So in the past year, I finally started dipping my toes in like semi-professional like game design. Like I'm working as a writer on a game with a small group of people, and we're working to put together like a small traditional RPG. And like one of the big steps for us is that like we're looking to launch a Kickstarter for the game like really, really soon. And like about like 3 or 4 months ago, like something came up like very briefly that we were like a little worried about, and that was like Mighty Number 9. And despite what you might think about the game or whatever, like it, like I understand people already kind of a lot of like ill will about Kickstarters, but the second that happened, my career was like, oh my god, no one's ever going to want to support a Kickstarter again, and we kind of need this for our game to work. So like as someone who's been like working close with like the person in charge of the project on like, you know, like designing the Kickstarter and getting it launched soon, like, do you have any advice on like, or suggestions of what you think like a project like ours or somebody else moving forward in the future would like, what they really have to do to make sure that like, you know, they have like, people know where they stand, like they have like their trust, or like, they know that like, hey, like, we know this system, which is great, has a really bad rep, but there's something there. And as a small preface, we are launching it with a demo, so we are planning to at least do that to give people something that you want.
I've done a lot of Kickstarter fun in the past 4 years.
Oh! We got there!
Kickstarter is tough. I mean, it's definitely tougher now, I think, than you started it, just because there's so many projects on. Like you said, there probably is more of a trust issue, a trust factor now. I would say the first thing is to, you know, just make sure that you accept the game. I mean, in a way, I think Kickstarter is a big marketing platform as well. So I think it's just really about presenting the game in a way that people can understand, people can gravitate towards it immediately. And at the end of the day, hopefully content speaks. And hopefully, like, you know, your story, the entire story in the video, not a chapter.
I mean, also, 1 second.
Come talk to me after this, I've run 13 Kickstarters.
All right.
And extra history for a while, and I really enjoyed your videos on the early schisms in the Christian church and such, and I have been playing a lot of Crusader Kings 2 recently, and as such, you've covered a lot of the Christian schisms, so I'm hoping that you guys will eventually do an extra history on the big one, the Chalcedonian split between Orthodoxy and Christianity, or in Catholicism, because again, Crusader Kings 2, that's a big deal in the game, so that's something I've been really interested in. I was hoping you guys have plans for something around that time period.
So, for any of you guys who don't know, all of our extra history comics are actually chosen by our patrons. But it was something that I even wanted to discuss, and there was nowhere near enough time. So we made middle Christian schisms at some point. It's definitely not out of the realm of possibility. You just have to convince our patrons.
Right.
Alright, next question.
So I'm not sure who to direct this at, but I'm hoping your cumulative knowledge will help. As someone who's a current developer and programmer for the iOS platform, how would you recommend getting into, you know, game programming without taking an associate job? Or if there even is a way. Because I don't want to step back in my career by, you know, major steps.
So you're doing iOS like app development right now?
Yeah.
And you want to enter the game side of things, at the same level or above?
Yes.
Okay.
Well, or a little behind, but general area.
So I have to ask, is the little behind financial? I don't ask any questions. But
no, that's, yeah, that's also acceptable.
Okay, so risk is the obvious thing, right? You take risk to make a product. Okay, that's all. I know that's going to answer your
problem. I guess, yeah, is there a way to get into this field without, like I said, taking an associate position?
Yeah, I mean, so when I first got my first job as a designer, I mean, you guys have heard this if you watch from 11 to my nephew and stuff, but when I got my first job as a designer, I sent out something like, I think 112 resumes, we got like 10 yeses, and it doesn't matter, right, because all those rejections are irrelevant. You need one to win in life, get the thing that you want. And so A, I would look everywhere, I would apply to everywhere, and don't give up, right? And I know that sounds right. And the other side of it is you can also develop something yourself and start on your sort of side and build up your game development resume with a bunch of small games and launch on iOS, and that will help bolster your chances for getting an ad position that you're currently at or somewhere other than building iOS.
One of the things I encourage my students to do is to transliterate a board game or a tabletop game to the iOS space, because you have total control, it's a cheap license to get, and then you have that on your resume to move on.
Anyone else? Any other thoughts?
I know, I actually went the other way.
Yeah, right, that's actually, I feel like a advantage would be the opposite, which I don't know if that's harder, honestly. But it's like, flukes happen. Like, sometimes you go and you make a thing on your own, and like, that thing is your resume. You know, don't count on that, right, but that's positive. Like, that is one way to do a thing, especially if you really like the thing. You know, it can happen. That's maybe a good thing to be like, hey, I'm also making this cool little thing that I think is interesting. You know, don't count on it. Like, you kind of got that in your back pocket.
One other thing. You can also make the transition, if you're doing a business like lower term, make the transition to a company that is producing iOS apps and iOS games, get in on the app side, like your position or above, and then ask to transfer, and very often it's easy to do in that corporate structure, so that's what I like. But all right, next question.
Thanks, guys.
Yes, absolutely.
Hello.
Hey.
I guess this is mostly for James, so I'm not sure if any of you guys played Spec Ops Online.
I have.
Yeah,
I have.
The reason I know is because your guys' in-depth analysis on it was one of my favorite series that you guys did. I love all the in-depth analysis. However, with this guy, is there room for Spec Ops, or really, is Undertale a better Spec Ops
than Excellent question. And also, by the way, we haven't really addressed Undertale because we felt like...
So like, no spoilers, hopefully.
Well, and like with Minecraft, right, it took us forever to talk about Minecraft because it takes us a couple months to do this video, and by the time that we were talking about doing one, everyone had said so much about it already. When we feel like we have something that's to add to the conversation that hasn't been said before, we most certainly will. I think there's room for a lot more of these sort of things. Have you played One Chance? You might want to take a look at One Chance as well. Anything that subverts our expectations and makes us think further about games, about the medium, is something that I would just want to see more of. You don't put it off enough, and encourage me to more maybe things.
I would also add, if you like that kind of fourth wall breaking metatextual stuff, also check out Pony Island. Yeah. Really, really good.
Oh, and there's this weird game, I don't know if it's very good, but it's called Beginner's Guide.
Weird, and then it's normal.
Oh, yes, it's totally normal. Every game, I hear that there's a narrator, and they're playing about how they built the game. Well, I mean,
I guess here's
my favorite part of Overwatch, actually.
I guess the thing that I'll mention in that is that I think there's some sort of, like, you know the old trope of, like, the engineers invent the medium and the artists actually use it to make stuff. Like, I think that there's an important follow-up step to the deconstruction, which is like stepping into the new space and owning it. I think it's very, I say this because I'm 100% guilty of it. There's a very real tendency to fall back on the, this is, I would be critical of Spec Ops and to some extent in this sense. I actually think Undertale does less of this because does so much more than isn't just this. Like, it's not really Undertale's only thing. But, like, I think you really need to, like, go somewhere past it, like, past the point where you deconstructed the thing and say, like, I mean, not that it's bad. It's great to, I think it's, like James said, it's important to have those things that break that ground. But I think that if, as an artist, the only skill that you have is, you know, pointing metatextually to the thing and go, hey guys, look at this, right? Like, I want to see people go, okay, great. Look, now we see that. Now I'm going to make a new thing that expresses the new space that we're in that isn't reliant on, because I don't think a good art medium is one that is constantly deconstructing itself. I mean, maybe in some aspect, but like in some aspects, it should also be constructing itself, right? And then of course it gets too constructed and it needs to be deconstructed and whatever. But it's like, you gotta have both, you know.
All right, so I'm trying to get through as many questions as we can before they move us to another room. So go for it.
Okay. Everyone so far has had really great open-ended questions. I've got a really objectively bad question.
All right, objectively bad.
Exactly.
So I can't actually disagree with you. It's objectively totally bad.
Right.
Right.
I just want to say thank you for.
That was terrible.
Question is, Mazda RX-7, are you a car enthusiast, or?
I was young.
Yeah.
Okay. It was very red. I have actually since ditched my car because I have said lots of things about, like, reducing consumption and all the other things, and I felt like I should live it. So now I am a carless person. I love that car.
Oh man.
That was my teenage car. And as far as the video goes, that was by far the hardest video I've ever had to write.
Never did it last
time. I tried to write an extra credit strip like 4 or 5 times. I threw it out. But I'm glad you're doing some good because when I was making that, I thought I was weird. And like that bug was all me, right? That I was experiencing something that nobody else was experiencing.
I just want to say thank you. It was a really powerful video.
Thank you for coming down. Thank you for just spreading out to you.
Hi. I was at the econ panel this morning. Great. And it got me thinking the Diablo free money market.
Yes!
And that was the thing that came out and failed and it's kind of gone. But you see that as a system in another game somewhere else coming back, and if so, what are like the biggest challenges for people or otherwise for that kind of
system? So I absolutely want to recommend this. Also, thank you for. At 11 a.m. this morning, we had a major panel on the economics of video games in Tokyo, and it was standing room only, and the fire marshals came in and pulled people out because of over capacity. And that blew my mind, because it's awesome to see how many people are so into like the things that matter for jazz games. So thank you for coming in and thank you for sharing all that. You have a point, and then I'm sure we have many other people.
Yeah, so it's one of the biggest challenges that the Diablo and all virtual economies face is that it's a virtual system, which is supposed to be a closed system. It's supposed to be a closed loop, but it doesn't actually exist in the purely virtual space. You've got the real world. And anytime you have any sort of virtual marketplace or virtual currency, there will be attempts to subvert it using real dollars. And every game that I work on at EA that has a virtual marketplace, we're constantly going after people who are coin selling, who are farming, who are using, you know, virtual assets and selling them. That's why we have it in the terms of service, don't do that. And it is a constant battle because those people wreck the experience for everybody. You got someone who has farmed the game and inserts 2 billion coins into the economy, and everyone else who didn't pay that guy in real money for the coins, they can't play the game. And so I think, and then from a legal perspective, when you have the ability to cash out, which is something that only a very, very few developers have attempted because there are a lot of like banking laws and you're operating a convertible instrument and it's very complicated. Then you also have issues with other legal issues that come up. And one of the things that happened this year was Valve getting in trouble for the skin trading market for Counter-Strike Go. And they got in trouble with the Washington State Gambling Commission because there were all of these people who were gambling, just straight up like casinos using virtual items as chips because they had this real world value and there were ways to cash them out. That is the biggest challenge by far with virtual markets and virtual currencies and operating it not in the vacuum of the game itself.
So I would argue that there is one other challenge. I think that the Diablo example, they did actually very quickly on multiple levels, then on the design level, right? If you break your economy and your economy is tied to the real world, somebody's getting screwed, right? But I want to ask you, have you seen Project Entropia or Entropia Universe?
No.
Really?
The PC game?
Yeah, it's a PC game. Years ago, it's a European company, and they got themselves a banking license. And they run a game where every item is transactable and every and the currency is just raw, you can trade it for euros. And it's worked for years. And
Marvin, so you played it too, right?
Yeah.
Oh yeah, so you want to talk about it all?
Yeah, I mean, if you want to shoot your gun, every bullet is a penny,
yeah.
Right? Is that clean? And farming makes you money, and they make new land available, and that land they sell for money. You can own an island for a couple €100,000. It's crazy.
But what's really interesting is if you're good at farming, right? If you're good at the game, you can make money on the game. If you're not, and it's obviously tilted slightly in their favor, and they've got a balance. Impeccably, because that's necessary for this. You will play it for a month and spend a dollar buying points, right? And it's a really interesting state because it also has that promise of adding more than you can purchase out. But you have that problem with them. What if they ever shut down the service, right? What happens when everything has a real world value that players can define and say, look, we have a price for this?
Right. The other thing that happens is any balance patch that you make, people are already, I already get like legal complaints when we do a balance patch. Some angry gamers will say, oh, you know, I've spent $1,000 this month and now my item isn't as good. If you're talking about something that has real world value that you're nerfing, that it just leads to way more legal threats and problems. So it is a really fascinating area right now that's growing really rapidly, and I think a lot of people are just now realizing the problems. It may be going a little bit faster than people can keep it.
I have a question for us that I don't know if we'll actually be able to answer, but someone in the audience might. So how does Wizards deal with it when they ban a card in Magic that has demonstrable real world value?
It does not have demonstrable real world value.
Twisted in circles to make sure that those cards literally never have demonstrable real value, and yet I feel like if anyone actually wanted to press that, it's really hard to say I'll let us support another, right?
Right.
So that's the issue that I love to look at. And I mean, clearly, right, you see in games like Magic, that there is a whether or not they can hide, you have a marketplace that is very functional and works for me. Of course, there's one that you're not injecting infinite currency into the game. Because that, again, has all the problems. But it's a really interesting problem that you're going to have to tackle over the next 5 years. I think we'll see more attempts at it, but I think more successfully.
Yeah, some of the baseball card laws cover that up. The laws about randomness impacting baseball.
So what you're saying is we need to lobby the government to make an exception for changing the
government.
Got it.
Thank you.
Yeah. Thanks for the question.
Hey guys, so my not-serious question for Davey is there any post-work being done on the IRS simulator from the not-serious game jam last night?
We made a game yesterday, and it's a very important game that's going to change the way the video game.
It's the most important game ever.
Being deconstructing the medium, I think that it's just gone now.
But there's no games are done. Pretty good first.
My serious question is directed at James and everyone else. I'm a YouTube content creator, and I'm very small. And my question is, how do you deal with burnout when creating content but not seeing return? Like, and that's
it's really human condition.
I know, right?
That, I mean, that is really good because I feel like all of us have had that experience, whether it's YouTube or elsewhere.
Yeah.
All of us have had to put in a great deal of labor into that return. Do you guys want, I think it's an important question. We just want to be scientific about it and figure out the problem.
Producing content requires a lot of passion, as you know, and sometimes you have to get deep in the well. I've worked with filmmakers who have worked for 20, 25 years without being recognized at all, and they continue to do it and make beautiful works that I think history will thank them for. But even, you know, if I can speak for my crippled self out here, what you create, if you believe it is important, and it starts a conversation, it needs to be made. And you, I think it's Truffaut who said, filmmaking is like having this, you should hold it till you absolutely have to, and then let it explode.
I mean, no one likes obviously putting in a ton of time and effort into something that they feel is important than getting like 36 views or something. Like it's a horrible self-doubt and crippling sort of experience. I think what gets me through either, for instance, so I've done some stuff in the YouTube space, but I've also pitched television shows. Some have gone through, some have not, most have not. And that's really the crux of it. Like, what I lean back on personally is I know for a fact that anyone who has done something successful, YouTube or otherwise, it has a large portion of the passion has been consistency. If you are constantly releasing content, the chances of your content hitting somewhere just increase. So as long as, for instance, like, you know, if you do a podcast or if you do a show on YouTube, if you have a release schedule and you release something every week and you're passionate about it, there's groups that are passionate about it, you have more opportunities to tell people about that or for it to be found. So I would say consistency is the most important.
Also, do you have a dartboard?
No, I have a group of manatees that just randomly shoot balls.
That's not okay, that works. That works.
Yeah.
Yeah. Ridiculous 9-month subscription, and it didn't work. But those failures, I always feel like I've learned something from that. And I just tell myself, it didn't work, but I'm smarter and I'm better and the next one get better. Beauty of consistency is, you get better, right? You just get better. More beginnings, middles, and ends. So the next new product gaming industry you buy would be that.
Yes.
So for me, there's two sides to it. One is, I remember this was kind of got dealt with something we talked about earlier. When I was in high school, always had his headphones on, right? Through class, I would have my headphones under my hair, so I could just be listening to music the entire time because music is vital to my life. I would not be here without music. And I had this moment where I was listening to something I realized, like, yeah, that's it, that's real, right? Like, I found a place where it sounded like I felt. And I realized that so I'm creating, if I can have, if one person gets that out of this, then I'm giving back to the world, right? And so that's always been for me. And then on the other side, at the same time, you have to believe in it. And by believing in it, I don't just mean keeping the content, but you have to do that, right? I don't just mean that you can get through. I mean, you have to do all the legwork. I went out and contacted the Escapists after we had a few videos and got us on there, and for all that was negative about that, it was positive, and even when we do not think ahead of account, we reach out and pay our games to look. I mean, we might be to reach out and work with you guys. And you have to do that so you're willing to work. You're willing to get along with one another. YouTube creators or fans, that's what they might be able to work with. You can't help but take that next step. And because you believe that it deserves that next step, that there's someone out there who will get something out of it if you choose.
That's taking a while because I have a story attached.
Okay,
I am a very big fan of knowing, of self-reflection. Why are you doing this? And be honest with yourself, right? I write in my other job, this job, because there are things I want people to think about, there are things I want people to feel, there are things I want people to reflect on. And I can only do that if I get ideas. That's why I'm here. That's why everything else that is disappointing, and there have been quite a few disappointments in my path to get here, is okay. But that's true for me. I would not presume that that is true in that particular mix for any other particular person. I can answer that question because I've thought about it, and I've been ruthless with myself, and I'm like, I need to do this. That's a function of reflection and growth and age, and I'm not in any way questioning or knowing what is driving you, but you need to know that, because that's going to give you the strength to get through something that's bad, or for you to find something you put your heart into, or what. If that's what motivates you. Short story, Ken. No, it's not.
Wait, you didn't call it this short story, so I'm assuming it's long story now.
Yeah.
I wanted to do a little bit more, get a few more ideas out there, work in different mediums and stuff, right? So one year, after a particularly rough patch, because the fans were giving us a lot of guff, right? Someone pointed out, hey, have you seen this episode of Extra Credit? Some of you might know that episode. It's a Firefall episode. It's a sponsored episode. It's not about Umbrella, right? The episode amounts to, wow, Firefall is doing something really ambitious. We don't know if they can pull it off, but one of their staff used to work on this game. You should check out. It's called Umbrella. That year, by serendipity, I happened to be going to PAX West for the first time. So I figured I should go and thank these people on my behalf and on my team's behalf. And I figured, and this is stupid, that the best way to find James would be at the EC booth. He was there. I walked up, I shook his hand, and I said, hi, I'm Fred, I work on Alpha Bar. Thanks a lot, and thanks a lot to my team. And his response was, cool. Do you want to do a panel? I am not someone who's afraid of public speaking. I'm also counsel. But I never, ever imagined doing something in front of a PAX audience, in front of James and a friend, who I subsequently found out was Morello, as my very first big audience panel. Aww. And you know what? Never hesitated. Not at all. I was petrified. But I knew why I was there. I knew why everything had amounted to that. And I knew I had to get through it in order to keep going and going and going.
getting this idea. And that worked for me. And for anyone who wants to create, there are going to be moments where there is nothing but your knowledge of yourself and where you want to go with your art.
Series
gets filmed? Is it more like a film in that regard, or is it still like a TV show? And what does this mean for film if series can be long-form films if you were to just sit down and binge them?
I love this question, and I love it.
Okay, that's a really bad question. And to be very brief about it, you're right, it's changing everything. Production companies are now changing how they organize from top down in order to accommodate the production. And we're talking about producing now large chunks of threaded stories. So it's become more film-like, but they are using a lot of TV methods to do it. So we're talking about smaller crews, talking about multiple editors, talking about multiple directors, all working sometimes simultaneously on different locations with a group of cast members. Additionally, they also realize that they have a very tight post-production schedule. So there are considerations about kind of centralizing post-production workflow. I have friends who work for some Hulu shows, I have friends who have worked for some Netflix shows, and when they describe it to me, they talk about things that I begin to really understand as more film junk. Honestly, all the rooms are pretty much the same. All the workflows are pretty much the same. Television used to shoot an episode in 8 days, they used to edit an episode in 18 days. Pretty much the same thing now, except for the longer content, it's a little longer to shoot, and they take a little longer to edit. However, it's also changing our viewing habits. That's something that everybody's really trying to struggle to capitalize on. Because we can tell a multi-part, multifaceted narrative now over a certain span of, you know, 1.5 hours, or that's like 2.5 hours, 3 hours. You can now tell it over 7 hours, over 18 hours. And this has dramatically changed how we approach stories that open up potential for narrative. So in the core of your question, it's really about storytelling. And that's what's evolving. We haven't landed where it is yet. It's a very cool thing. And the medium is opening up. There are more opportunities now than there have been in job creation, in development, in writing, than there have been in 25 years. This is the moment to strike while you're on time.
I mean, I just want to get you another question, so we have time for one more, but I agree with everything this man said. And that's very good about stuff, yes.
And thank all of you for talking to us.
All right. A few years ago at Magfest, I met this guy who made a game called The Stanley Parable, and I said I might as well check it out. And I finally did, and it was possibly the funniest game I've ever played, so thank you. A question, actually. When does Chipmunk James make an appearance on Extra Credits?
That is really, we've talked about letting Neely do the voice for me if I ever have to speak or do that. I don't know, Dan is such an integral part of this, both as a voice and as a secondary filter, right? Because I read all the episodes, but we don't want it to be just my perspective. And so we go back and forth, and it's really good to have him as a person who's in the end going to have to say it, because he has to be true. And so it's fun to talk to people. I have if I didn't feel like bias had to be me by a person, I probably wouldn't do it that way. Because we simply can't produce 30 minutes of animated stuff while I ramble. We cannot do it. I wish it'd be less in front of the camera, and so I probably will never speak. But we'll see. But that was an excellent way to wrap us up, sort of. So we are not done. As many of you guys as are really do, we are all going to march over to Mages 1, and at that point the real thing. Because our medium is interacting, so huge should these things be. I hate actually the fact that we're all so fine with people and we're all out there. We'll form a big circle, we'll have a discussion. Don't put the game all the way out, we're good. And surely you all really appreciate it. Alright, we'll give you a thumbs up. Google sign up for the I think that is an absolute. So we're all on Mages 1. If you have any other questions,